I'm Dr. Tricia Ting. I'm a neurologist and regional director of the epilepsy program. I see patients who have seizures and epilepsy predominantly. A lot of times people are not sure whether they're having seizures or not, and doctors will send them if people have had loss of consciousness, blacking out, even shaking spells, and they're just not quite sure, is this a seizure disorder? We usually start with a clinical visit to our outpatient clinic, again, where I would be able to get some details of the history around the circumstances of the seizures, what types people are having. Then we want to get more information related to brain waves, and we do a study that's non-invasive. We have electrodes taped to the scalp, and we do an EEG, or electroencephalogram, where we have the patients lie still and just relax, and that's how we can look at different rhythms of their brain and evidence for a seizure disorder, which might be abnormal spikes or sharps or other types of abnormalities of the brain waves. Once we can figure out what type of epilepsy they have, because there are many different types, we'll understand what their likelihood is to need medication, because a lot of times we can control seizures with medication and let people lead very normal lives. It's very natural when I first see patients, maybe with their first seizure, that there's a lot of concern on many levels. They're wondering, what can I expect in my life? Is this a life-threatening type of ailment? Will I have another seizure where I black out with no warning, for instance? And what is this repercussions for my treatment, my lifestyle? Can I have kids? Can I get married? Can I drive again? So epilepsy or recurrent seizures is a high impact diagnosis. So we want to make sure that we make the right diagnosis. Having a diagnosis of epilepsy today is much more hopeful than we were decades ago. We have a lot more medications available now that are approved and work very well. Moreover, these new medicines have a lot fewer side effects, both short-term for tolerability as well as long-term side effects. Beyond medicines, we also have a lot of options for surgical management of patients with epilepsy who don't have their seizures controlled with medication. Now we're able to, with the high technology we have, really hone in on where the seizures are developing in their brain, and in many cases we can offer different kinds of surgery, whether it's resecting that tiny area of the brain that's not functioning well for them, or even implantable devices are now available. It's highly rewarding to be able to help someone who's been having spells or seizures feel that they have some control over it, because the problem with epilepsy and seizure disorders is the lack of control, the feeling that you don't know when it's going to hit you. You might be driving, you might be at work, you might face embarrassment, you might be injured from it. Patients are very thankful because when they come in, they're very anxious and they're worried. And once we've had that consultation and I can tell them what it is they're experiencing, what's our plan of action, what's their likelihood of having control or understanding what's going on, they are much more relieved. And they often leave saying, thank you for explaining things to me and giving me this hope. Epilepsy is a condition of recurrent seizures that occur without warning and without a reason. Seizures are actually electrical storms of the brain, and there are many different kinds of seizures. There are some focal seizures, there are some generalized seizures. People think very classically of a grand mal, and that's an example of a generalized convulsion where someone is blacked out, they may shake all over, they may get very stiff and fall down, hurt themselves sometimes, and they generally last a few minutes. Other kinds of seizures can be very subtle and just very brief, few seconds of blanking out and staring. People might smack their lips or do some automatic behaviors, but they can be very quiet types of seizures, yet still really impact someone's life. If you were to recurrently have episodes where you black out for 30 seconds at a time, that's still quite an impact on life and health and safety. There are many sources or reasons someone might get epilepsy. Often it can be a small injury to the brain, whether it's from a stroke or a growth, a tumor, or just something they were born with, like a little birthmark on the brain. Why it happens at different times of life is often a question I get. They'll say, okay, Dr. Ting, you found a cortical dysplasia, or again, like a birthmark on the brain. Why did I not have a seizures from birth? Why did I only have it when I was 20 years old or 30 years old? We know that there are a lot of factors that impact someone's seizure threshold or the likelihood they will have seizures. And these can be hormonal or related to stress or general health or fatigue. So sometimes it takes a perfect storm for someone who is at some risk for epilepsy, but normally if they're relaxed and not having too much stress, they won't have a seizure. But a perfect storm might happen if they have the flu and they have their menstrual period, or they've been up many, many nights in a row for exams, and then they go out and have a party and drink a little too much alcohol. All these might come together to lower their general seizure threshold and then to the point that they individually will have a seizure. The broad categories for epilepsy are focal and generalized, but the types of spells or attacks or seizures they can be highly varied. So we like to divide them into focal onset versus generalized onset epilepsies to help us to give the patient a better idea of what medications and what treatments are available to them and what medicines work best. Because some medications may make a generalized onset epilepsy worse, and some treatment options like surgical options are better suited for someone with a focal onset epilepsy where they have just one area of the brain that starts off their seizures that can be taken out. Many people can have a single seizure in their life, and usually they won't have another one. The problem with treating a single seizure is that you might be wedding someone to have to take a medication that has toxicity, that has side effects for the rest of their lives, and they may not need it. So if someone with epilepsy has recurrent seizures, we wait generally for a second event to start treating with a seizure medicine to prevent a third or fourth. Some patients may grow out of their seizures. This is what a lot of people hope for when they come to see me. These are often sort of childhood epilepsies that people, as they reach their adolescence, may not have any more seizures and don't have to worry about taking medication. That is often seen in absence epilepsy, for instance, which is a generalized onset seizure disorder. But not everybody has that kind of epilepsy. A lot of people have epilepsy that we call focal onset, and it may be from, say, a birthmark on the brain or a lesion. Maybe they had head trauma at one point or a stroke. And these sort of things set up the brain to have one area of malfunctioning neurons that will continue to fire off. And it's unlikely for many of these people that they would grow out of their seizures. So yes, some people have to take medication for the rest of their lives. But the good news is that with the current medications that we have available, newer ones that have been developed, people can live very normal lives without side effects, without worry of long-term toxicity from their seizure medicines. So I tell my patients it's often like taking a high blood pressure medicine if you've been given a diagnosis of hypertension. It's not that big a deal if you can just continue to take it all the time. Many women with epilepsy do come to me when they are thinking about getting married or having children because they're worried that their seizure medicines may affect the health of their baby, and that's very natural. Especially since historically there were traditional seizure medicines that were known to cause serious birth defects. The good news is currently we have many newer medications that are safe in pregnancy, that have been followed in big studies at academic centers, looking at the outcome for many women with epilepsy who are taking some of these newer medicines, and we are able to reassure the patients, my women patients, that they can definitely have babies and be still on their medication. The fear is, you know, I really try to tell them, you don't want to just stop your medication because there is a risk if you were to do that, that you would have more severe seizures, even status epilepticus, which is a life-threatening prolonged seizure disorder. Problem. if you were to just stop your seizure medicines, and that's not healthy for a baby either or the mother. For people who have a generalized epilepsy, what we now call generalized genetic, it is somewhat more hereditary and can be passed in the family members. But even then, the risk remains very low. And often, generalized epilepsies are very easy to treat. So it shouldn't be the reason people decide not to have children. The medicines that we're using nowadays are very safe. They've been fully evaluated with lots of patients taking them, and they're approved by the FDA. They are safer in many ways than herbal medications they may get from a natural food store, because herbal medications are not vetted in the same way, they're not tested in the same way to show that they're effective for seizure control and necessarily safe. And often herbal medicines do have medicinal effects and can interact with the other medications, so it's not without some risk. There are certain diets available for children, and now even adults. In children, there's something called the ketogenic diet, where it's very high fat, very high oils, but no carbohydrates. It's a very difficult diet, so we really can only manage it in young children. Once people start living their lives and going out and trying to have adult life, it's very hard to maintain that type of diet. So there's been much work on a modified ketogenic diet, which is almost like a low-carb Atkins diet. And there's some evidence that that is helpful for seizures. So in patients who are interested, I do tell them where they can get more information about this and explore that possibility. But even with certain diets that would be more palatable, like a South Beach or Atkins diet, there can be side effects to that, like high cholesterol or weight loss. That is something that people have to consider. An EEG is an electroencephalogram. This is one of our basic tools in the epileptologist's regimen to look at what kind of seizure someone's having. What it involves is putting electrodes on the scalp and measuring the brain waves. It's very similar to an EKG that you might get in a doctor's office or in the emergency department, where they put electrodes across the chest to look at the heartbeat. We do that on the scalp, and it allows us a picture into the natural brain waves when someone's awake, when they're asleep. And often we're able to see abnormal spikes and sharps that I tell people it's like a live wire that's kind of going off and sparking off in their head. It gives me a sense of what their risk of having a seizure might be. Because if you were not to have those, sometimes our medicines can control that. We realize that there's a lower risk if those types of abnormalities are not seen on the brainwave. Usually we'll have EEGs done in the very beginning of a diagnosis to get a better understanding, again, of what kind of seizures someone's having, because that impacts our therapeutic choices and prognosis. After the first one or two, sometimes they need a second or third one if the first one is not as helpful. Maybe they didn't fall asleep or we didn't see any abnormalities, but generally multiple tries at it may reveal an abnormality that's very helpful for diagnosis. Often EEGs are very short, maybe less than an hour long, and it's only a sampling. We'd like to see a longer period of time, maybe even catch a typical seizure that someone might be having, maybe only when they sleep in the middle of the night. In those cases, we can bring people into our hospital. We have a specialized epilepsy monitoring unit that allows them to sleep with the EEG on, and specialized nurses to care for them should they have a seizure. And we may keep them in the hospital for several days and get a lot more data and information on the types of seizures they're having, whether they might be surgical candidates if we can figure out exactly what area of the brain the seizures are coming from, and even try to change their medicines while they're in the hospital, again, to achieve better seizure control, all while they're being monitored by the EEG. Well, the monitoring unit is highly beneficial, mostly because it allows us a longer sampling time of someone's brain waves through many states, while they're awake, while they're asleep, and several days of it. It allows us to pull away some of their medicines. If someone is having seizures despite being on medication, we can pull off the medication, catch a typical seizure, because sometimes that happens when we pull seizure medicines off, and again, have really the gold standard diagnosis for what their attack is. Not everybody who blacks out has seizures or epilepsy. Some people who black out might have complicated migraines or cardiac syncope. They might even have stress or panic attacks that really mimic seizures in that they come without warning and they black out. So this helps us because if it's an epileptic seizure, we would know with the EEG tracing that's going at the same time as their event. And it's really hard to do that in the outpatient setting, so we bring them to the hospital. Once we have a good idea of the diagnosis of someone's seizures after those first sets of EEGs or even prolonged monitoring in the hospital, we don't always have to do regular EEG studies after that. It really depends on how someone's doing. If they take a turn for the worse, say they went from being seizure-free on medication, suddenly spells are coming back or seizures are returning, we might get another EEG at that point. Or if we know what the source of their seizures are, again, if it's a tumor or mass, we can reassess that with a repeat epilepsy EEG study. But it's not always necessary to be a yearly or even every couple year event. It's really as needed based on the clinical picture. We have many medications that work very well for seizures and to control epilepsy, but sometimes someone's seizures just cannot be controlled even if they're on 2, 3, 4 medications, and that gets very frustrating. They have a lot of side effects often, and still dealing with seizures they can't control. We can offer other therapies. These include surgical therapies that in some cases might even cure their epilepsy if we can remove a small part of their brain that's what I tell the patients is malfunctioning, is not serving us well, but only causing problems and causing the seizures, the electrical storms. We would only, of course, remove those small areas if we can pinpoint it, know exactly where it is, and it's in a removable area. If it's not removable area or they have multiple sites that we really can't get all the little spots of problem, sometimes they might benefit from implanted devices. Those are the latest and newest treatment options in the surgical realm, and we could implant devices so that we don't have to remove parts of their brain, but just shock those areas to deplete the possibility of seizures. Generally, people are able to drive with seizure disorder if their seizures are controlled and if their seizures are not happening during the day. There are some patients who, for instance, only have seizures when they're sleeping at night. Since they're not driving while they're sleeping, they may be allowed to have a driver's license and a permit to drive. But generally, patients have to be seizure-free on a medication to be able to drive. Usually recommend to my patients that they, if they feel it could be helpful for them, that they seek out other patients who are dealing with the same issues. Because epilepsy is a life-changing type of diagnosis. It involves a whole lot of different issues, including even just social stigma. Some people feel like they don't want to share that they have seizure disorder. So it's helpful to have other patients to talk to. And there are many support groups. Ones I recommend are available through the Epilepsy Foundation of America and can be found online at epilepsy.com.